Have a show idea? Have you always wanted to host your own show? Well, contact us at sockradioshows@gmail.com. Let your dream begin here.
Currently live on air on Sock Radio, listening to me, Kim Mehlhopt. I work under the name Sounds Like Spirit. I'm a psychic medium. I'm a Reiki healer, intuitive healer, spiritual teacher, spiritual counselor. Who let me loose with a radio show of my own? I think Julie will have to take the rap for that. But I'm here to discuss anything spiritual that you want to talk about today. So think of it a bit like an online meeting of like minds, or a bit of an online development circle, for want of a better phrase. I just want to check first with those that are in the chat room. Thanks so much for Janet and Tracy, who have popped in early to start us off here. I want to make sure you can hear us at the moment, and that we're coming through live on air, all okay. I just wanted to start off the day with something that's a wee bit topical for us here in New Zealand, and that is there's been many earthquakes, and I see from a short stint watching the news yesterday that there is a few earthquakes going on around the world at the moment too. From an energetic point of view, people who are spiritually open or energetically susceptible, for want of a better word, will very much be open to picking up this energy that's being released by Mother Earth, being released by Gaia, and coming up with ways to deal with that can be helpful. So I just wanted to mention, if you haven't done it before, you'll notice some people during a very large quake will get quite nervy, quite jumpy, and you need to know that that's because you've picked up a very, very large amount of energy that we're not designed to handle. So the best thing we can do here, of course, is give it back to Mother Earth and ask her to heal it and deal with it. So the best way you can do that is a slightly meditative state, if you like, but it's not required. Just imagine the soles of your feet opening. Ask for permission. Always, always ask for permission. And send the energy out of you back to Earth, along with some healing and some love. Obviously, these earthquakes are shaking up because there are rents in the ground. There are shifts in the plates. So the Earth needs a wee bit of healing. When you're feeling this on the physical surface of the planet and in your physical body, then it's because the Earth's in need of a wee bit of healing itself. So it's a good idea just to send that back so that you're not holding it physically yourself, and throw that back through there to Mother Earth to deal with, along with some healing and some love. Just very quickly, just wanted to mention that I put some stuff up online yesterday about chakras under the terms of tools of the trade. Now, I know some people wouldn't consider chakras to be tools of our trade, but if you don't think they're important, try working when they're blocked. And just something very, very important to note is recent earthquakes, along with things like jet lag from overseas travel and seasickness, they all have a similar sort of reaction within you physically, energetically. That's when your internal operations in your body, or your center of balance, etc., and the external receptors like your sight don't match up. And this happens often when anything upsets your balance, and earthquakes are a particularly huge part of that at the moment. There is a very simple holistic solution for that if you're not into modern medication, and that is ginger, of course, root ginger or ginger tea. If you're like me and you're not quite so holistic, ginger nuts, ginger beer, ginger bread, ginger ale, anything with ginger in it would pretty much keep you covered in that department. And I'd just like to welcome, who have we got coming on now? Jody's here. Thank you so much, Jody. We're having a few issues with sound. It's a wee bit faint, apparently, but I'm sure the lovely producers, Julie and Colin, here today will get onto that for us. Does anybody have any questions about how to deal with earthquakes, either physically or emotionally? Because if there's any questions on that, welcome along, Carol. If anybody's got any questions on how to deal with those earthquakes, so the short answer very, very quickly for that is send back the energy that you've picked up from the earthquakes back to the Earth, along with healing and love. and the holistic solution to feeling better when you get that seasickness feeling, because the ground rolls quite a bit even after and in between the shakes, is ginger of any form. So we'd like to welcome everybody that's in the chat room at the moment. If anybody's got any questions, feel free to pop in there. I know I'm new to this, but I'll try and multitask for you. I'd like to thank our show directors at the moment. There was a tech issue, but according to Janet in the chat room, that's now been fixed. So thank you very much for that. And right, moving right along. So if you haven't, if you are feeling a wee bit shaky after the earthquakes, do get into ginger or ginger tea. The other thing that I would suggest too is an intuitive or perhaps a Reiki healing, any modality that you're into really. But the body tends to hold shock in the adrenal regions, which you can actually sort of self-feel. Here we are in our first show, and I'm telling you to feel yourself up already. But by that, I mean, if you put your hands just on the sort of bottom to the middle of your rib cage on your back, that's the area where the adrenals show through. And whether you're emotionally handling things well or not after an earthquake, your adrenals can hold considerable shock there. I know when I've done healings for people who have been through stresses like the earthquakes, that there's a huge amount of energy being drawn in that region. So it is something to keep an eye on. Jody's coming. I'm having trouble reading that in the chat room. Is it Demichi? And Jody here is saying she visualizes pouring oil on the earth, but loves the idea of ginger. Well, it is the holistic approach there, Jody. So as I said, good idea if you want ginger or ginger tea. If you're being a little bit naughty like me, gingerbread, ginger nuts, ginger ale, any of those things would work. Someone's saying here, if we send to the system of the ley lines, yes, you can do that. I feel that probably works better if you have more of an idea of exactly where the ley lines are and whether they're major or minor and what their job is. And you're right, yes, the ley lines are the chakra system of the earth. Thank you very much for that. Do you have to be an empath to feel earthquakes? No, Tracy, you don't. Not at all. This is something that I'd like to point out too. A lot of empathic people don't necessarily know that they're empathic people. Now, this is something I go on the warpath about quite a bit. I feel that a lot of people today are diagnosed with things on the mental illness spectrum who are probably very strong empaths. Everything from bipolar or schizophrenia, as they used to call it, depression on any level, people with serious addictions, ADHD, all those sorts of things. I personally believe that most of them are very strongly empathic. And because they don't know that and don't understand what that means and don't know how to deal with that, what ends up happening in their physical and emotional lives is they take on board all the energy and the stress and the pains and the negativity from others. And of course, that's too much for any one person to handle. They don't know how to deal with those feelings. So a lot of people will self-medicate with things like alcohol or gambling or sex addictions or food or any number of things. So the long and the short of that, Tracy, is no, you absolutely don't have to be an empath to feel the earthquakes. But a lot of people who don't consider themselves or don't know themselves to be empaths will be certainly feeling it. It will affect some more than others, but do, you know, be aware of how you feel physically and emotionally during the earthquakes or after the earthquakes, because understand that shocks from earthquakes can go on for quite some time. I think I saw a post on Facebook within a day of the Kaikoura ones here a few days ago saying we'd already had 382 aftershocks, and that would be right. And a lot of those were considered events in themselves. In New Zealand, anything over a 5.5 magnitude is considered an event. So I do want you to be aware that, you know, even for some time after what people consider the actual event, there are many events still occurring during the earth and from the earth, and you need to be aware that they will still affect you if you are susceptible to that sort of thing. We've got Janet popping in here on the chat room going, stem ginger, Of course, you could always get it pickled. Pickled ginger, where do we use that? We find that in sushi, don't we? We find that in sushi a lot. What do I advise for folks who are taking all that in? Oh, Jodie, yes, we did mention this a wee bit earlier. I know we had a few sound problems, but if you've taken in a lot of energy, are you talking about the energy from the earthquakes, Jodie, or are you talking about the things that you pick up empathically from other people? Just give that a minute to come through. If it's, okay, the nausea, Jodie's telling me here she gets nausea, stomach stuff, headaches just before earthquakes. Fantastic, Jodie, you've got an early warning system in there. That's great. So, you know, next time you feel like that, you know, make sure everything that's up above your head has been secured and that you found a safe place to sit or stand. Lucky you. But I understand what you're saying there. Now, this is exactly what I was talking about earlier. Your chakra system's very easily put out of balance by things that do affect balance. And the things that affect balance are things that cause a rift between your internal organs, like your endocrine systems and your center of balance and that sort of thing, and your externals, like your sight and your hearing. This happens during earthquakes. It happens during on boats during seasickness. It happens when you cross timelines and you get jet lag. So these are all about sort of clearing excess energy away from you and centering and balancing yourself. So very much to start with, Jodie, the issue with the earthquakes is to, I always imagine opening the soles of my feet. I ask permission from Gaia and I send that energy back through. The reason you get nausea, stomach stuffs, headaches, that people get jumpy and nervy is because they're holding on to all that energy that's just been released. And our, you know, tiny little 5'1" whatever bodies are not designed to handle energy of a magnitude of 5.5 or whatever. So do make sure you send that back to the earth and send it back with healing and send it back with love. So I'm sorry if that's just a wee repeat of what we started with earlier, but I understand our sound was a wee issue earlier. It's been sorted now. So I hope that helps, Jodie. Absolutely. Do what you need to do first, you know. Maybe even ask your guides to help you with that. You can say, I feel the nausea, the issues with my stomach, the headaches. I've got the message. Thank you. Please take this from me. Sometimes the moment we say, I have nausea, I have a sore stomach, I have a headache, we own it, rather than saying, my stomach is nauseous, my head is aching, what is the message here, please? You don't want to take that on board and keep it as something that you're going to have to learn to physically deal with or get rid of over the next couple of days if it was just there as a message, just there as an early warning system, just there to let you know something's on its way. And I've got Dimitri coming in saying people in the UK were feeling this before it happened. Absolutely. A lot of people will do this. I've known people that can feel these earthquakes coming, like they can feel the ground shuddering, a bit like imagine a large truck driving past you. They get that sort of feel. I've known people who can hear them coming. They hear a change in vibration. They start getting buzzing or they're ringing in their ears, changes to different frequencies, that sort of thing. I've known people that have seen it coming. Those that see energy via colours can see these things coming in advance. So just wanted to let you know, you're none of you are crazy. You're as sane as I am. That might not be as reassuring as I think it is. But, yeah, and Janet's chiming in here too with stomach upsets but hadn't associated with the earthquakes. I'm glad that you've pointed out there, Janet, that you knew that it wasn't yours. That's exactly what I'm saying. When don't say I have, because that's when you do own it, and then you've got an issue that you then physically need to deal with. I always look at anything that comes through my body first and foremost as a sign. What is this telling me? What's the message? I have a crick in my back or neck. I have an ache in my left knee. I have some stiffness in my right elbow. So I don't say I have a sore elbow. I don't want to own it. I want the message if that's all it is, because I'd rather learn from it academically than physically, if that's the way I want to word it there. Happy to help, Jody. Yes, it is good validation to know that you're not the only one that feels these sorts of things prior to major events. You'll find that the more you talk to people about this sort of thing, the more you understand that you're not alone in this, you're not the only person, and that it's by no means uncommon to get symptoms like this prior to particularly large events relating to Earth. I mean, we're very attached, obviously, to the Earth. Yay, thanks for gravity, people. But so anything that happens to the Earth does affect us very, very strongly. And as I said, particularly more so those who are open to this. What have we got here? Dimitri's got, some people are picking up the upset in the world, like Brexit and Trump getting into power. Can we feel this the same way? Absolutely, yes. I would like to say at this point, though, Dimitri, that if you do get a lot of negative feelings from things like watching the news, could I suggest not watching the news? I know that sounds like an obvious solution, but I try and keep away from a lot of world news. The biggest reason for that is that if you are empathic, and most empaths are healers, then you want to save the whole world. And while that's an admirable sentiment, I don't believe that taking on everybody else's sorrow is the way to heal the world. And I have the same feeling about wars and things like that. I don't think you stop wars by feeding into them and talking about war. I think you stop them by talking about peace and talking about love. And I think you stop them by giving what you need to give to yourself, and once you've got what you need, passing that on and helping your neighbor. And I think it works one person at a time. Jody's got here, been told, feel this prior to the event in order to repair. Prayer work, absolutely. I've got absolutely no objection for prayer work. Any of those that have been in a dire spiritual situation, and I don't want to be alarmist, but if you've been working in a home doing house clearing or something like that, and you've seen or heard or felt things that have frightened you, for want of a better word, and you've pulled in that prayer and that white light and you've seen the effect it has, then you would be in absolutely no doubt that prayer work is valuable for all events. Oh, good. I've had a good idea. Dimitri goes, good idea. Well, remember that one. Thank you, Kim. I'm not quite sure which one was a good idea, but excellent. I love to know I'm helping somebody. But not watching the news. That'll be what it was. Okay, the train leaves the station, doesn't always stay on the same track. So if I wander off too far, do pull me back and let me know there. But I don't watch, isn't it funny, considering I mainly work on Facebook, I don't actually pick up a lot of news off Facebook either. My belief is something that was told to me by somebody in a lovely free seminar at a spiritual expo once. She said, if there is something of importance going on in the world that I need to take action on, then someone will let me know. And I'm a firm believer in that, that is the case. And so I try to keep away from the negativity. I mean, you know, the good and bad of being empathic, obviously, you watch the news and, let's face it, you most of it's not pleasant, for want of a better phrase. It's all about sensationalism. It's all about getting the ratings in. It's all about shock factor, and that's great. But as I said, if you're empathic, you pick up far, far too much of that. Obviously, you can get equally excited and jumping up and down and thrilled over, you know, articles about puppies and people's weddings and things like that. But it's not necessary to feel all those highs and lows all the time. You can block some of that. You can ask that perhaps only what you need to feel to help yourself or somebody else comes in there, Or you could, as I said, just do what I do and don't watch the news. I don't even watch it on my Facebook feed. I really troll through looking for that sort of thing. I feel that if there's something I need to know, it'll be told to me. And I feel that if there's something that I need to teach others, that will be shown to me as well. So I don't get too worried about that. But absolutely, the power of prayer is awesome. The show today, Sounds Like Spirit, is much about anything that you wish to discuss. I've just started with the earthquakes because they're relevant in a lot of people's minds at the moment. But just to sum it up very, very quickly, if you're feeling nauseous or anything like that, ginger tea, gingerbread, ginger nuts, ginger ale, anything with ginger in it, the more natural the better, obviously. Do send healing and love back to the earth. Don't hold on to all that energy. If you feel you're still being affected, time after the quake, and do remember shocks go on for quite some time, that you might want to get rid of the shocks in your system by having a healing of some description. I'm a Reiki practitioner, so obviously a big fan of that. And prayer is an excellent idea. New Zealand's not a very large country, and I've had a friend recently who's gone over to the west coast of the South Island here in New Zealand to heal the land. There's been a lot of issues over there with the land, everything from earthquakes to the 29 that died in the Pike River mine disaster. So the land was in need of some healing and the people were in need of some healing, and that's done through prayer. It's been done through group prayer. So absolutely, Dimitri, way to go with that anytime. I see we've got Christina on board in the chat room. Welcome, Christina. And you're right there, Dimitri. People do tend to not understand themselves very well and tend to focus only on the negative. Isn't it funny? This came up in a chat about tarot cards the other day. I've got a couple of lovely decks that I use on Sounds Like Spirit. I do a free intuitive angel answers on Sunday on the Sounds Like Spirit page. And I leave that up for 24 hours. And if you've got a burning question, it's up to you to get into a meditative state or focus on the question you want answered. Choose whichever card you're drawn to, one, two, or three. And then within 24 hours, I reveal the answers and you've got your answer if you want a wee bit of external guidance there. But what came up about these cards is I do know people that use cards that are really quite negative. So it's funny you're talking about how people only focus on the negative. And it was interesting to note that even a lot of people in the spiritual world can do the same. And it is erroneous. And don't get me wrong, we're humans, some days much to our disgust, but we, much as we try for the high road all the time, sometimes there isn't. But I was looking at these cards the other day and they were very, very negative. And I've had a lot of people come back to me about this particular deck of cards, and it's Doreen Virtue and Radley Valentine's Oracle Angel Answers. And the reason I use these cards is because they're so positive. Now, I don't want to assume, and in fact, I want to point out that people are not stupid, and that you understand for, you know, it's scientific. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. So for every positive, there's a negative. So when I'm getting answers, I don't want to be given the negative. I want to be given the positive on the understanding that if I don't do this, there is a possibly negative consequence, but I would rather focus on the positive of that and look forward to trying to action that than worrying about what has gone wrong or what could go wrong. And it's the same with everything else. You know, even back to this earthquake topic, focusing on the negative, a lot of people are very panicked and very stressed about what'll happen. And I've taken a wee bit of a kind of zen-like approach to it recently, and that's thanks to one of the lovely ladies in my Tuesday night development circle. But she said, well, I've given up worrying about it. And I said, fabulous, how did you manage that? And she said to me, well, in the grand scheme of things, you know, if I'm supposed to be here, I'm supposed to be here, and if I'm not, I'm not. And I thought initially that was a wee bit fatalistic an approach, but then I thought, well, she's probably right. You know, if you're supposed to be here and to carry on and to help people, then you will be. I am not by any stretch of the imagination saying don't take precautions. In fact, I can tell you right now that there is a what we call a wheelie bin here, and it's plastic rubbish bin on wheels, and it has supplies in it, all the water required for three people for 3 days, emergency blankets, torches, that sort of thing. And it's not a silly idea for anyone anywhere to have an emergency kit available. And obviously take precautions if you feel an earthquake and it's gone what they call long and strong, which is it's rolling or shaking for more than a minute, then absolutely make sure you get yourself to a very safe place. Dimitri's saying, can't use the rider things. What are the rider things there, Dimitri? Pop that through and we'll have a chat about that. Just a wee note. At the moment that earthquakes, like any other major events in your life, it's not the events that cause the issues, I don't feel. I think it's the way you handle the events. To put it in a sporting terminology, it's not the hurdles in life, but the, you know, the way you jump them. And I think that comes down to attitudinal changes. I think a lot of life comes down to attitudinal changes. If you focus on the negative, then you're going to attract more circumstances to bring about the things that you're not happy with. And if you focus on the positive things, then equally you are going to bring about circumstances that will bring more positivity and happiness into your life. That's all about manifesting. It's very important to try and focus on what you want. And I'm stating there the what you want, not the how. We had this discussion not so long ago in one of our classes about people saying things like, wanted $1 million. Don't we all, darling? And I was thinking to myself that actually a million's pretty minimalist these days. It wouldn't get you very far, maybe buy you a home if you were wanting to use it for other things or help others out. $1 million wouldn't be very much. But just they decided that, you know, the best way of that happening was to win the lottery. And I thought, well, that's fantastic. But there could be, you know, 1 million ways the universe could bring that money to you. And if you've decided that the only way that you could have that money is to win the lottery, then you are narrowing down the universe's options for bringing that to you, maybe even blocking it. Just give me a moment here. I'm trying to multitask and we've got... Okay, Dimitri's saying, yeah, not a good way to look at it. If you're meant to be here, you will be. Just look back and see how you survived something you thought you would not survive, but certainly take sensible precaution. Oh, the tarot cards, the rider things. Okay, I'm with you there. No, you'll find original tarot does have a few very negative cards with negative connotations. However, a lot of that's the way they've been viewed over the years. Like the death card, for example, I don't think in the last few years I've ever brought up a death card that means death as in death of a person. It means the end of something and the beginning of something else. So it's more like ending an old phase and beginning a new one. So once again, it's an attitudinal change that's required when you're looking at some of these cards. Thanks, Dimitri. Yes, I think it's a good idea that I'm still here. I'm still here too. Not wanting to shuffle off the mortal coil anytime soon. But just a note to those who have just popped in. We've just been talking for the last, half an hour's gone by already. We've been talking for the last half hour about earthquakes, how to deal with them energetically, and how to deal with the physical symptoms that come from those. I'd like to move on to something that has been huge in my mind and in the mind of a lot. Sometimes when you hear me talking about stuff that I teach, I'll just clarify right up front that I'm no guru by any stretch of the imagination, but my journey fascinates me, as does everyone else's, endlessly. I'm endlessly fascinated by everyone's journey, and if I find out any new information, I like to pass that on to anyone and everyone to see if it fascinates them also. What do you mean, okay, me shush do? Absolutely, Janet. One door closing, another door opening. That's exactly what we're talking about. Now, I'm just going to, if you'll bear with me for a couple of minutes, I'd like to read something out to you. And it's about people stealing your power. I don't know how many of you have read the Celestine Prophecies, the 10th Insight, done the workbooks that go with those. But it's all about our own development or raising vibrations or ascension or whatever you'd like to call it. I've got a wee poster here that says, anything that annoys you is for teaching you patience. Anyone who abandons you is for teaching you how to stand on your own two feet. Anything that angers you is for teaching you forgiveness and compassion. Anything that has power over you is for teaching you how to take your power back. Anything you hate is for teaching you unconditional love. Anything you fear is for teaching you courage to overcome your fear. Anything you can't control is for teaching you how to let go and trust the universe. Now, I put a wee post online about this under my weekly quiet time on Saturdays that I do on the Sounds Like Spirit group. So anything that has power over you is for teaching you how to take that power back. This is an old lesson, but it's a great one. There's much to note in that wee poster. But this is the lesson for the now, and this might sound a bit rough, but bear with me. It's a message that Spirit's ringing in over and over to make sure I let you all know that everything is for teaching you. If you don't understand the lesson, and I'm not a big fan of the word lesson, so let's say experience, you'll repeat it until you do. Understand this, that this physical life is about experiences, and if you do not learn from them and move on from them, thanking them for and understanding the lessons, you will get the same experiences repeating in similar ways until you do. Here's the harsh truth. Let's say you are 50 years old and you live until you're 80. You have another 30 years of repeating this experience. So let's say you are in an abusive relationship at 50 and you live to your 80. You've got another 30 years of repeating that abusive relationship. If you are younger, then you've got longer. And when you come back in the next life, you'll be starting those same lessons at square one. Are you keen? I thought not. So the message here is to stop living in the past, thank the experience for the lesson, forgive those involved, including yourself, and move forward. So here endeth the lecture. And I'm sorry about the intensity of that, but too many of us need to think on this right now, and I include myself in that, too many of us. Sometimes the pussyfooting around has done as much as it can. So pass on with all the love in the world, learn the lesson, move on. Now here's a phrase that got me in trouble, but I'm standing by it. No one else is victimizing you. You are victimizing yourself. Time to stop that. Any thoughts on that, guys in the chat room? For those of you that have just joined us, you're live on air with myself. That's Kim from Sounds Like Spirit. We're currently running the show live, Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls. And basically anything that comes into mind, anything that's popped up during the week, any psychic phenomena that you'd like to discuss, we're talking about here live. I'll be here for another, there's another hour and a half. You stuck with me through till midday here. And I'm just talking about at the moment how people that annoy you, for want of a better or weaker phrase, are sent to teach you. This comes up a lot. I quite often have people come to me wanting answers on things that have happened in their life. It could be a problem with someone at work. It could be an issue with a family member. It could be, and here's my favorite because it's the most common, accusations from people around you. It could be any of those people or it could be friends. And they'll say things like, what's a perfect example? Oh, you're just jealous of me. There's one of my favorites. You're just jealous. Or they might say to someone else, you've got a huge ego. She's got a huge ego. Understand that those things tend to be a mirror, more a reflection of the person that said them than that the person they were apparently aimed at. Janet's coming up here with moving on is hard though, because we tend to hold on to the pain even though we know how destructive it is to us. Just a quick note here, guys. Last week we did a class on the supermoon because it was appropriate. but it's valid for all full moons and any time of day or night, to be fair. But lunar energy is very, very good for this, and the lunar energy from a full moon particularly. when you're feeling the pain from those sorts of things, the way you've been treated, awful things that have happened within your life, All emotions are valid, even those knee-jerk reaction ones that, you know, our first physical thought might be, how rude, how dare they? And our second thought might be a little more spiritual. Well, I'll send them love and peace and success. I'm ever thankful that the universe doesn't read sarcasm. But the words are important. But the point here is that those feelings that you have about how you feel mistreated or abused or used or used as a scapegoat or put upon or overloaded or any of those things, all those feelings that you feel are valid. Now, from a spiritual point of view, we are souls enjoying a physical experience. We've been put here to experience energy in different forms through our physical life, through being a physical being. And so all those emotions, all those stresses, all those feelings of unworthiness and all that sort of thing are things we are supposed to feel. And sometimes the best way to move on from those, Janet, is to actually sit with them for a bit. And as I said, full moons are excellent for this. If it's a cool night, then take out a wee blanket, a comforting blankie, a chair, a wee picnic chair or something like that, or an old mattress, or lie down in the grass. Expose as much skin as you can. The guys in my class always laugh when I say clothing optional, but the Wiccans had something with their full moon ceremonies. The more skin you expose, the more positive energy you're able to pick up. But how you dress or not dress is not the most relevant thing. What is relevant here is if you can sit with the pain. Now, this is harder than it sounds because we spend our life trying to avoid this pain. And I'm watching you in the chat room, Janet, and I'm hearing you. I feel you. I've been there. I've done that. Sit with the pain because it is a valid feeling. And we spend a lot of time trying to suppress these valid feelings. No, I'm okay. We minimize it. No, it wasn't as bad as I thought it was. We try and put the responsibility to someone else. Oh, he'll change. Or they'll suddenly become a nicer person. I only have to put up with it until, I don't know, they go into hospital or I'll be okay tomorrow. It's just the way I was feeling. We try and subvert ourselves and do other things. We don't think about even any of that. We go, oh, well, I won't worry about that right now. I'll just do the dishes. I'll just vacuum the floor. I'll just go and visit my friend. I'll just so we either excuse the feelings away or we cover them with what I call creative distraction. But none of those things actually solve the problem because all those feelings are still there and you still are coming from a place of that pain and a place of that abuse or whatever it is that you have. So when I'm telling you to sit with it, when I'm asking you to give that a go, it's actually more difficult than it sounds because you sit there and I want you to focus on that pain. I want you to focus on those reactions that you have to those people. I want you to focus on how miserable they've made you feel. Sit with that for a minute. And I tend to find that I can sit with this for maybe less than a minute and be in tears already. But it is about release. So sit with this under a full moon and just, it's a bit easier to let it go. It's a bit easier to move on without carrying that pain. And it's a bit easier to see the next steps forward. But I do want to be very, very clear on that. That if you don't see the lesson, don't thank the universe for it and move on, then you will get it again. And a perfect example of that is jobs, employment. If you have a job that you are absolutely miserable in, maybe you work for an absolute tyrant, there's a lot of those that pretend to be very nice on the surface, but very wolf in sheep's clothing and no, Jody, I'm not putting down the wolves, Jody White Wolf. Wolves are fantastic, but I'm just saying that they appear to be something different to what they're initially showing you. And you can, and I hardly ever use this word, but you can hate that job. You can hate those people you work with. You can hate for those all of those circumstances that you're in. And you can apply and wish and hope for a better job, and you can even get one. But the fact is, if you don't change the attitude to the job that you are already in, the next job is going to result in a similar set of circumstances. So you need to change around your thinking. You need to have an attitudinal change, because you need to think of the things that's about gratitude. Gratitude is, I read it somewhere the other day, gratitude is vitamins for the soul. This is what keeps you healthy. This is what keeps us going. This is what raises our vibration and moves us forward. This is what allows us to take action, is coming from a place of gratitude. So instead of going, I hate my job, I hate these people, I hate the way they make me feel, you have to start changing that to an attitude of, I love that I have an occupation. Maybe you don't like the people, but you could say, I really enjoy the work that I do or the help that it provides other people. I am thrilled that I am financially supporting myself. I'm excited to get up and have a purpose every day. I enjoy the routine of it. So focus on the things that you can be grateful for, and then go and look for your new job. Because if you don't change that attitude about the job or about the people, then you're going to find yourself in the same situation. Now I'm just going to have a quick wee read online and see what's going on here. Okay, so Demetra's got a problem with the banking, and they're telling her how she can and can't use her PIN. She's going, she may not remember her PIN, but no matter what, the bank will accept it either way. And you've learned to talk to them and say how you are and how you feel. That's exactly right. And that's what I'm saying when I'm saying sit with your feelings. Your feelings are valid, you know, and your opinions are valid. And you need to be able to voice those. And if you can't voice those through any form of oppression and that makes you feel bad, then you need to sit with that and clear it so you can figure out a way to move on. Janet's chiming in here with a change of perspective. That's exactly right. And I often have people say things about, like the glass is half empty and that's a pessimist, and the glass is half full, that's an optimist. And they're all missing the point. The glass is refillable, you know. Energy is open and it's available to anyone and everyone, not just psychic mediums. All you need to do is ask for it. Christians ask for it through prayer. Spiritualists ask for it through energetic force. Healers ask for it through themselves as a channel. You know, energy is available to everyone. So, yeah, I don't understand sometimes the perspective of people that think everything's negative or this glass half full. Now, if you'll just give me a moment, I've just missed a wee message there and I can't seem to figure it out, but give me half a second. Okay. All right. So we're getting, I've just got some wee words from my producer. Yes, I've got too much dead air. I apologize for that, Julie. I need to figure this out. This is my first time. So I thank you all for being here in the chat room with me today. For those that have just joined us, you're listening to me. That's not a very helpful segue, is it? My name is Kim Mehlhopt. I work online under the name Sounds Like Spirit. for those of you that have, just joined us, you can access me online. Sounds Like Spirit page is a business page where I talk about development circles and upcoming expos and that sort of thing. And I also have a group, which is all free and for support, including free readings on Thursdays and things like that. And I cover a lot of topics off that we cover in circle on those online forums. So if you do need to get hold of me, Sounds Like Spirit on Facebook is the place you can do that. Obviously, all going well with the show today. This will be a weekly thing, and you'll be able to find me here from 10 a.m. till 12 noon New Zealand time every Wednesday. I do believe that starting tonight, 8 p.m. till 10 p.m. New Zealand time, I have a lead-in introductory show talking about clear senses, and that's a lead-in to the clear senses course that I'll be running online through SOC Radio. Now, I understand from the lovely Julie Sock that if you are a paid-up member of SOC Radio, these courses are either free or very cheap for you to access. I'm not sure on all the details on that. But I may get Julie to pop into the chat room at some stage and give us information on how and where to do that. So if you aren't a paid-up member of SOC, there is a place You can go to do that, and that will give you access to things like these Clear Senses courses and obviously all the courses that all the other lovely people attached to Soc Radio are putting through here as well. Thank you very much, Dimitri. I'm doing great. There we go. All right. Just getting back to what we were talking about before, you've got a fear that you will be stuck and unable to be you. I've had some quite some experience with this myself, and numerous times. I think I'm not a big one for dwelling in the past, but I do believe that sometimes in order to move forward, you need to have a look at some of the major traumatic events in your life. And I'm not talking about seriously dwelling them, just a bullet point list, if you will. And the point of this list is to have a look at all those situations, and here's the frightening part, and see where you enabled them to happen or where you enabled them to continue. Now, I'm not saying you are the cause of the dramas. I am not saying that you are to blame, but nor am I saying anyone else is. If someone has caused you abuse of any sort, understand firstly that they are coming from a position of unhealed hurts within themselves. I know that physically doesn't help you at the time, but it does help you to understand that it's their job in this life to be that antagonist for you. It is your job to learn the lesson and move on from that. And when I have a look back, I'll get personal here. Let's have a look at relationships. I think we were engaged at the time, so I'll call him my fiance, was cheating on me when he went away to study up in the North Island. I had a similar issue with my now ex-husband, and a relationship that ended recently that was reasonably abusive, had similar issues, although it wasn't another person he was cheating on me with, it was an addiction. But the other side of that coin feels very, very much the same. But the fact is, just looking at those three examples alone, I can look back and first of all, forgive myself for staying in those situations as long as I did. And secondly, forgiving them. People always say forgive the other person involved, but they forget about you. You can often hold quite a bit of resentment against yourself for staying in a position as long as you did. There's often a lot of regret. Why did I stay so long? Why did it take me years to get out of that? Why did I not see it earlier? But the thing is, you need to forgive yourself over those things, because if you were in the same situation, and I firmly believe this, with the same information, you would make the same decisions. So there's no point in wishing you could go back and change it or regretting the time you spent. There's a lesson in all of that, even the time that it took to get through that and the time that it takes to get through the change in status once you move on from that. So I just want to say, first and foremost at this point, forgive yourself. I will come back to that, but I just want to point out that Julie from Soc Radio has just popped into the chat room for us, and she's put a wee blurb up there. That's lovely. So, recognizing the signs of spirit with Kim Mehlhopt. Oh, that's me. Starting Wednesday the 23rd tonight. That's 8 p.m. New Zealand time. That's 7 a.m. UK time Wednesday. Join this new session to develop your understanding of the clear senses and connection with spirit in your everyday life, not just as a medium, but in your lifestyle, open to all members. Developing it later into a full course in the Lyceum. So check it out and get in there for your premium membership to take the course. Thank you very much for that, Julie. If you're able to put some instructions in there on how they become a premium member, perhaps the steps to take and any code they'll need coming through me to do that, that would be fantastic, so that anybody who doesn't know how that goes, including me, can sort that out. Yes, so Dimitri, back to that, talking about the abuse there. I know when I'm doing spiritual counselling and either the message has come through strongly or the client has recognised that a change is required and they need to move on, There are things that no one tells you. No one tells you how difficult it's going to be to rearrange your life. After this, no one tells you how lonely you can feel sometimes. No one tells you how difficult it can be to move on from the history in your mind that you have with somebody. No one gives you all that difficult stuff. But having said that, I wouldn't want to give it to them either because, you know, the important thing is getting yourself out of a not so favorable situation or a dangerous. Hi, guys. We're back. Ladies and gentlemen, we're experiencing technical difficulties. Her name's probably Kim. No, I don't know what happened there, but it has been fixed. Can you all hear me? Yep, we're coming through. Can I just get a wee confirmation in the chat room there that we can all hear me? That would be fantastic. All right, for those of you that have just joined us, my name is Kim Mehlhopt. I work under the name Sounds Like Spirit. I am, that's a wee nod to the fact that initially when my senses came back in strongly as a grown-up, my first and strongest sense was clairaudience. Also, outside of the spiritual world, in the real world, I'm a singer, so hence working under the name Sounds Like Spirit. Bit of a cosmic joke on my part, really. But I run a couple of pages on Facebook. One of them is the Sounds Like Spirit page, which is for business, where we talk about expos and development circles. And I do those locally here in Christchurch, New Zealand. But coming up in the near future, when I get my head around some technical issues, I will be running some of those online. Also, just a wee note here that I will be running a Clear Senses course here through SOC Radio's Lyceum in the not too distant future. In fact, tonight and Wednesday night next week, we'll be having a lead-in, two-hour lead-in shows to talk about that and what's going to be coming up. There's been a note put in there by Julie that if you go to spiritualistsonline.com, register on site and upgrade to premium, which is £30 per year for all level one courses, free and more. And free, you can choose to do courses for a fee per session. But it's a really, really good way of doing this. When I do courses, I'm not usually a big one to talk money, but when I do courses here locally, you know, you can pay sort of $150, $250 for sort of 8 hours worth. And if you pay $30 here for a premium membership, then you can get access to most of these online courses free. Okay, so we've got a note coming in that the sound is coming back up. So it sounds like we're all back up and running. So the sound's been a wee bit quiet. Thank you very much, Dimitri, going, I've covered all you were talking about and that I do it better. I do it better. I don't know about that. Everybody does it different. Okay. So, Jodin, you're talking about intermittent flickers of what? Let's hope you're not contagious. Me too. Don't think you can catch it through a phone line, so we're all good. Intermittent flickers of what there, Jody? I'd love your power. Do you mean your personal power or do you mean the power in the house? Just checking. Because an earthquake-prone New Zealand over here, there's a lot of intermittent flickering of power in the house. The joke in our family, and it's not really a joke, really, it's really awful, that every time the lights flickered on and off, someone would yell out, bodies through the dam. Not the case, of course. New Zealand here runs on hydroelectric power, which means we get our power from water running through turbines creating electricity. So it's a relatively clean way of doing it, apart from the dams creating havoc with the local ecosystems, of course. Okay, I've just got a note, Julie, please, from Janet in the chat room that the sound's low again. So whatever we needed to do to fix it last time, if we could do that again, that would be fantastic. So a little bit of blatant self-promotion here. You can get hold of me on Sounds Like Spirit online. The group that I run under the same name online on Facebook is basically an online development circle. Every day I chat about something. I have the header on the top of my page is purple. So on Monday I put up Sounds Like Spirit, which is anything along the lines of clairaudience or what do we call it? audio hygiene, which is about the sort of things you're listening to and gossip or the way people talk around you or music or any sorts of things that come to your physical hearing or your clear hearing. Tuesday, we talk about tools of the trade, and tools of the trade could be anything from a particular type of crystal to how to use runes or pendulums or this week we talked about chakras. Wednesdays, I do a topic on heal yourself, which could be something to do with healing yourself physically or emotionally, or it could be to do with spiritual healing. Thursday, I do free readings, so New Zealand time only Thursdays. What is the time? 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. You can put up a single question, and myself and a group of lovely friends who are also psychic mediums or clairaudients will help answer those for you. Friday, we talk about valuing you, and this is everything from how to pump yourself up internally to how to react when others aren't valuing you quite so well. Saturday's quiet time, meditation for want of a better word, but not always. Sometimes we just talk about ways to calm certain situations or how to react to things that go on in your life. Sunday, we talk about soul food, which is whatever happens to have grabbed my fancy for the week that I feel needs to be passed on. And we have discussions on those posts every day. I'm going to make you all very, very jealous right now. The Sounds Like Spirit page is my business page. And I list a lot of events up there. So if you could all, I'm happy for anyone and everyone to friend me personally. That's Kim Mehlhopt. But of course, you can find me as admin on any of those sites. But what we have on the Sounds Like Spirit page under events is any upcoming events that I've got coming up. And we do a lot of local events here in Christchurch. We have a couple of sort of medium-sized spiritual expos on the last Saturday of the month, on the first Saturday of the month. We have the Body, Mind, Spirit here twice a year, sort of roughly around March and September, which are huge. I have two development circles here on a Tuesday night and a Wednesday afternoon. And as I said, I'm looking at getting those into an online format at some stage so that those of you who aren't in good old Aotearoa will be able to join me for those. And any little deals and things coming up, any of the SOC radio shows that I'm doing are all advertised there as events. So if you need to get hold of those or want to know when they are, you can get hold of all of that information on the Sounds Like Spirit page on Facebook. Now I'm trying to get a message through here and I'm having trouble with it. So give me half a second. I've got the lovely producer trying to talk to me and I cannot find her message because it's disappeared off my page. All right. So we're in the chat room at the moment. We've got, I'd like to thank you all so much. We've got Janet in here, Jodie Whitewolf, Dimitri, Julie, Tracy popping in and out. I'd like to thank you all very much. This is my first show here on SOC Radio and I'm thrilled to have you all here. Is that my link you've put up there, Tracy? That's fantastic. Thank you so much for that. So if you like the page, and I think there's a subscribe button, then any events that I have coming up will be notified directly to you. And that includes, obviously, all the SOC radio programs that I'll be on. So, yeah, if you'd like the Sounds Like Spirit page and click the subscribe button, it never shows when I'm on it, but I'm admin, so that could make a difference. But if you'd like to do that, then you will be notified of all these events, including all the SOC radio events that'll be turning up with me in them. So if you're interested in those, absolutely. Thank you so much for that, Tracy, popping my wee link up there. That's fantastic. I'm a very busy lady. Yes, I am, and it is wonderful. It thrills me endlessly, and it's something you'll hear me say a lot, is be fascinated by the journey. I have a lot of people come to me with issues, spiritual issues, and that could be anything from random lights and orbs appearing to seeing visions that frighten them a wee bit, either premonitions or general dreams or clairvoyance. they come to me with issues about energy and things that have turned up in their house. And, you know, and it might sound a wee bit disrespectful, but when somebody comes to me with something that they need looking at in their home, for example, they've got some negative energy, they're like, I'm really worried, we've got this problem in our house. And I'm like, yippee, ghost busting. So it may sound a little disrespectful, but I don't intend it to sound that way. But it's part of this attitudinal change we were talking about earlier. If you can change your attitude to the way that you look at things and be fascinated, as in, wow, there seems to be a vortex in my house. This is fascinating. Let's go look it up and see what we can do about it. So it's very much about getting excited about these things. And I do get excited about these things. You know, when I'm sitting there in a circle and I'm, I don't know, spouting, teaching, for want of a better word, and somebody will say, don't look now, but there's a giant blue man in the corner. I go, oh, don't worry about him. He's just one of my guides. But I'm fascinated by these things. They don't freak me out much at all. And I think that is to do with a change in attitude towards these things. I know a lot of other people can be very fearful of spiritualists or mediums or people that have good active clear senses, frightened about the things that we can see and do. I just want to put everybody's mind at rest for those of you that may be listening that may be new. We're not mind readers. I have a friend who became a Reiki master a couple of years ago, and after a third attunement, she suddenly had access to a lot of people's information. Now, we all have the stuff. We all have clear senses, but it got to the point where she said to me, I can't go for a coffee by myself. And I said, what do you mean? And she said, well, I'm sitting at the cafe table and I'm hearing about the trouble, the relationship and the couple over there, and how on the right-hand side of me, her sister's been abusing her, and the issues that someone's having over there with their mother. And she said, I'm never alone. And I said, well, actually, we're never alone. We're never alone. And as I said a wee bit earlier, it's something that is a bit of a joke in our house. People often walk past me and go, oh, it's sarcastically. They say, are you talking to yourself? And I smile and go, nope. Because at the very least, I'm talking to my higher self. And at the most, I'll be talking to guides or family members in spirit. And even if I don't know if they're there, or even if they're not talking back to me, or I've got no direct return communication from them, I do still talk to them as if they're standing right beside me, because they are. So absolutely talk to the people that are around you. And the, once again, the train of thoughts disappeared from the station there. There'll be another one along shortly, don't you worry. So lots of stuff going on at the moment on my Facebook page and my Facebook group. Lots of stuff going on at SOC Radio at the moment. It's very exciting, some of the shows and things that are coming up at the moment. And as I said, if you would like to be alerted of any of the ones that I'm on, keep an eye on the SOC Radio page. And I do also Spread the Love as an event from my page. And if you're subscribed, you will get direct notifications for that. Thanks so much to the lovely guys in the chat room for offering to put my information, share my information on your page. That is awesome. You are welcome to share my events and contacts with anyone. Because the more of us get together, the more often, I think, the better off we'll all be. It was funny, we were talking earlier about earthquakes and the number of you that had nauseating feelings from them and headaches and stuff like that, or an awareness before they came and things like that. And I know it was very reassuring to one of the ladies in development circle last night to find out that she wasn't the only one that felt like that. She was starting to think it was just her and it was abnormal. And it was nice for her to have it pointed out that it's just an energetic connection and you're just picking it up in advance of the earthquakes, as a lot of spiritually open or empathic people will do. Now, I'm just going to take you back to some information on my – actually, I'm in the mood to do a wee card pull, and this is – I'm not often drawn to do this, but I've got a deck sitting in front of me and it's kind of calling to me right now, so I'm going to shuffle that and pull a card out for you. Like with any psychic tools, and tarot cards of any form are a psychic tool, you do need to ask for protection before you start. So right now I'm calling on the divine white light of protection, but you can call on God, Goddess, the universe, energy, universal energy, whatever higher power it is that you aspire to. I like to call on the Brotherhood of Light. I'm not an overly religious person, but I was raised in many different religions. I was christened Methodist. My father was a Baptist. My grandmother was Catholic. My uncle was a major in the Salvation Army. And as a singer, I got to go to a lot of these churches and get a lot of different viewpoints on spirituality. And I think that's why I believe it's individual. And what works for somebody may not work for you. And I think if somebody does something that's different to what you do, then you should by all means respect their choice to do that. Being a healer, I can't help pointing out if something they're doing is what I consider to be harmful to them. So I will say that. But after that, of course, you have to back off. So just with any psychic tools here, I always ask for the divine white light of protection. I ask for the Brotherhood of Light, which is the archangels, Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, Ariel, and Uriel. They're kind of like God's little army, for want of a better word. I think of them more like the heads of department. And they take care of everything from spiritual knowledge to protection to emotional balance and healing. Not that there aren't many other angels that do similar jobs, but those are the heads of department, for want of a better phrase. And so I always ask for the divine white light of protection, and I ask for the highest good of all. I always want answers for the highest good of all. You wouldn't want to do a reading for somebody or draw a card for somebody or be passed some information through your clear senses that was helpful to somebody but harmful to you. So always ask for the highest good of all. Now, I was shuffling the cards and I was intending to actually pick one out for you, and one of them has just fallen out. I'm a firm believer in synchronicities. This is from the Sonia Choquet Trust Your Vibes pack. For those of you that haven't had anything to do with this lovely lady yet, she's got an awesome book out, and I can't remember the name of it right now. And I haven't read the whole thing, but excerpts keep coming at me from it. And it's about walking your truth and not being as crazy as you thought you were. So I'm all for that. But this card that's fallen out today is a card called Call on Your Joy Guides. Now, we have a bunch of guides. My favourite phrase is a buttload. We have a buttload of them. Kiwi saying, sorry if you're not from around here. We have a buttload of guides hanging around us, and we have a variety of types of guides. You're not always aware of them, and you don't need to be aware of them. I know I have a master guide. I know he's very large and he's very blue. I know he's very pushy. And I know for the most part he wants me to figure stuff out for myself. I know that he hasn't given me his name, so I'm not too worried about that sort of thing. But you have guides that take care of everything, and you'll find this, you'll notice this particularly when you change situations in life. It's interesting to note that let's say you shift job and you may be working in, say, food service, and you go to a job where you're working in IT, and you've got all these fears and worries about how you don't know, this is a new job, it's a different field, you don't know what's coming up, and then all of a sudden you find you're actually really quite good at this. So it's quite possible that you've had a guy that specializes in tech type stuff pop forward and say, here, let me give you a hand with that. Same thing if you go from being without children to having children, whether that's looking after them in a daycare situation or having children of your own. You think there's no way on earth you could ever know all that stuff. How are you going to do it? You know, you don't want to be the one who ruins the lives of little children. And then you find out, well, actually, you're quite good at this. And I think in those situations, you'll find you'll have specialist guides that will have popped in to help you out with things. So we've got a card come up today that says, call on your joy guide. So you've got a guide that brings you joy. Now, it's not that the good joy guides can't do their jobs. They're very, very good at what they do. They're always there, and they are thrilled to bring you things that bring you joy in your life. But we have this pesky little thing called free will. So I just want to ask a quick show of hands in the chat room here. Who has, at any time today, asked their guides to bring them some joy? Because I'm almost willing to bet not one of you. So, and this comes down to not that the joy guides can't do their jobs or they can't deliver something that would bring us joy. It comes down to the fact that we didn't ask, and a step beyond that, often we don't feel deserving. Understand that regardless of your situation, how, when, what, why, that you are always worthy and you're always deserving. So call on your joy guides. You may be going through situations at the moment that may feel critical, but don't allow it to become too serious or you'll lose your way. Remember that on a soul level, this too shall pass. Regardless of where you're sitting right now, everything changes. So it will pass much easier with the help of your joy guides to lighten your mood and elevate your vibration so that you can move on to better times. Learn to recognize when your joy guides are on the scene. They do like to play games, practical jokes. I do believe mine are fond of hiding my keys. I don't know how much of a joke that is. Really annoying when you've got 10 minutes to be somewhere on the way out the door. You're locked in with a deadbolt and you can't find your keys. But okay, guys, I hear you. So they're with you to keep you from taking things too personally. They're good at getting your attention with their antics. Oh, here we go. Yes, they may hide your keys. They may move things. They may steal one of your socks out of the dryer. Are the joy guides capturing your attention? Where or how are they getting you to relax a little and laugh at yourself? Let them. But please make sure you ask them. I have several things that I ask for. Jody's coming with me, actually. No, not specifically a joy guide, but absolutely ask. I have several things that I ask for every day, and they may sound a little unusual to some of them, but we're all on this wee party together, so I feel free to share. The first one is that I ask to see something that I haven't seen before. Now, that's fairly wide-ranging, and I understand that. But what that means is I don't care whether that's in this world or whether it's in a different world through astral travel or where it is or if it's new academic information or new ways of looking at things or relationships or things that are out of this world. I'm pretty cruisy on how that comes to me, that I ask to see something that I haven't seen before. I ask every day for clear direction. Now, I'm not quite sure my guides are listening to me on this one. They tend to give me multiple directions and go, there you go. which way are you going with that now? It's almost like, haha, we just want to have a see and have a bit of a laugh and see what you'll do next. And so they give me multiple options on a daily basis, which is not actually what I'm asking. I'm asking for clear direction. But I have given this information to people. They have asked for clear direction and they have received it. So that's very exciting. The next thing I always ask for is a gift. And this is because, you know, I'm worthy, I'm deserving. I love and accept myself. I'm worthy of love, whatever your affirmations are for the moment around that. But everybody is worthy. Even the ones that you consider to be not worthy, they're worthy too. Everybody's worthy. And maybe if they received a little something each day, they'd see that a little more clearly for themselves. And so I always ask for a gift. And the gift can turn up in any number of ways. I remember the first day I asked for this. I had a development circle that night and a lady that was in it, her aunt had passed away some time ago and her family members were going through the estate, that's what they call it, going through the estate. And she found these old round tin biscuit tins, and they had a whole heap of crystals in them. And she gave me one and it was like about the size and shape of the likes of a Fabergé egg, but it was a very large piece of labradorite. And for those of you that don't know, labradorite is a crystal. And among other things, it's a stone for those that take the path less traveled. And that made me laugh. But I mean, I don't know what it's worth. It probably would have cost me about $60 or $70. But the gift can be anything, big or small. I went out yesterday and a friend shouted me a cup of coffee. And I thought, well, that's really exciting. There's a wee gift. Didn't ask for it. It was unexpected. So I ask for a gift each day. And it fascinates me to see how it's going to turn up on any particular day. So I ask to see something I haven't seen before. I ask for some clear direction. I ask for a gift. And I ask to call on my joy guides. I want something that brings me joy today. To be fair, you lovely people here in this radio show will be my joy today. I've been fascinated by the process. I have enjoyed talking to you all. I know it's not quite the same as face-to-face, but it's pretty close. And it fascinates me endlessly that we can do this across the world, that we don't have to be sitting in the same country or the same town or even the same room, and that we can connect like this across the world. Yes, Janet's chimed in here with pretty crystal labradorite. Yes, it is. It reminds me very much of power shells. I know that's not what they're called overseas. I think you call them abalone, something like that. But power is a local Maori delicacy here. Personally, I'm not big on seafood, but The shells, once they come out, they've been polished on the inside by the power while it was alive, and the shells are beautiful rainbow colors and hues of blue and green and silver, and they're beautiful. And labradorite reminds me a lot of that. It shines as a stone, much in the same colors. Comes in various degrees, obviously, from a very, very light blue to a dark, dark, almost black, but it is a beautiful stone to have around. So joy guides, that's the card that's been pulled out for you today, and it's telling you to ask. And you don't know me all that well yet, people, but I can tell you the first thing that I always say when anyone comes to me, I had someone visit me last night in my room and I go, did you ask who it was? I discovered the other day that this happened and it was all very synchronistic, and I started to wonder and I go, did you ask? people don't ask. And once again, there's that pesky free will coming in on things, because without free will, we wouldn't be the different species that we are. So free will has a huge part to play in everything. And I find it has a huge part to play in how we develop spiritually and with our clear senses and things like that as well. Have you asked? You know, a lot of people block themselves. You might be talking to somebody who's clairvoyant and you go, oh, no, I don't get visions. And I'm like, keep saying that to yourself and see what happens, because you find if that's what you keep saying, that's exactly what will keep happening. Be mindful that it gets addictive, Dimitri's telling me. Absolutely. Do you think it's the labradorite that's addictive or the joy? I think it's probably both, to be fair. I love communicating with spirit and whichever way that comes. And in my personal life, much as I do work as a psychic medium, in my personal life, most of my messages come through synchronicities. They don't come through directly through clear senses. I don't hear or see or know or feel. I mean, I do a lot of all of that, obviously, on a daily basis. But the messages for me personally, the stuff that comes through for me personally, tends to come through as synchronicities. Dimitri's just saying she remember to ask for the joy guide. Absolutely ask for the joy guides. Do it on a daily basis. This is something you can do in the morning. There's that lovely state that we have just before you wake up. Well, you're awake. You're definitely awake, but you don't want to open your eyes. That feeling when you're awake, but you just don't want to open your eyes just yet. And that is an excellent time to set up for the day. That's an excellent time to ask to see something that you've never seen before and ask for some specific direction and ask for a gift and ask for some joy. Joy is, it's a subject that no one covers off much, but it is the reason for being. That's a huge sentence to make about a three-letter word, but I firmly believe that. I put a post up on the Sounds Like Spirit group on Monday under the Sounds Like Spirit heading of Aretha Franklin, singing a song, and it's a very powerful song, and I put it up as an example of what happens when you find your joy, because too many people have the head down, working in the rat race, keeping themselves creatively distracted with the minutiae of life, and they forget to pay attention, forget to pay attention to the purpose, which is developing yourself here. So I'll apologize for the not so flash quality of the recording that I put up there, but it shows what it needs to, and it shows that when you're acting on your passion or your soul's mission, that the evidence and the power of it is unmistakable, and anyone who's heard this woman sing will know what I'm talking about. I said here that I was raised on Aretha's Respect and her song Think since I was little. And her words and her life are inspiring. She's done more for women's and minority rights than most of us will ever dream of. And she's done it with class and a smile and while following her true purpose. But if you look closely at the clip, you'll see the passion and the pleasure she gets from her singing and her performing and the joy and the emotion that it brings to others. So her soul's power and her soul's purpose shine, even at this much, much later stage in her life. And the channeling and ownership of self is immense. That's something that I would like to say here, that if you come across anybody that's at the top of their field, any field, and that's from nursing to veterinary assistants to IT specialists to counselors, if you come across somebody that is very, very good at what they do, you'll find they have channeled information, because it's what gives them that, the soul is what gives us that extra something special, that extra spark, that bit of pizzazz to our physical life. So do ask your joy guides for that joy every day, because it doesn't matter if you do things that bring you joy as a hobby or as if you do it for a living, but it is important that you do it one way or the other. You must do what brings you joy, what you're passionate about. It's hugely important. Janet's made a note in the chat room here that she has happy songs that she plays most days, that just listening to them for her is a joy. I've got friends that are much the same. And these are friends that have had some serious challenges, suffered through and survived, obviously, cancer and things like this. So music is very, very uplifting. And being a singer, you'll get no argument from me on that. I also had a wee chat yesterday to a few people about chakras and how each chakra has a note that belongs to it from the C major scale. So if you're listening to music or if you're singing, then you're probably hitting those notes at different times and self-balancing and self-clearing. So you tend to find people who are into music are particularly well-balanced in the chakras because of their singing. So it's a wonderful thing to have. So see if you can find that joy in a day, because it is the thing. And a lot of people seem to think that unless they're doing some massive work in the world, or unless they're giving everything of themselves to others, that they're not a valuable human being or they're not worthy. But the first person you should give joy to is yourself. And this is one of these fill your own cup first things. You know, when you're in an airplane and there's an emergency and the oxygen masks drop down, what's the first thing they tell you? The first thing they tell you is put on your own oxygen mask first. Even if you've got an infirm 80-year-old gentleman sitting next to you, even if you've got young children under the age of 4 sitting next to you, you put on your own mask first, because if you are not alive and well, you are of no use to anyone else either. And I'm not saying no use at all, as in not completely. I'm just saying there's not much you can do to help somebody else if you're not doing much to help yourself. So it's about filling your own cup. And the way you do that is with joy, the things that you are passionate about. Janet's made a note in the chat room. I have a perfect singing voice till I open my mouth. Lol. But listening is a great second best. You are right. You don't have to be able to sing to feel music. I've people who work in fields like composing or musical producing in shows or directing shows, stage shows, sometimes just working backstage on props and things like that. There's many great composers that haven't been able to hear their own music, yet they still got joy from even just writing it. There was some scientific study online not so long ago that the tunes, some of the classical music has been found floating around out in space. Now, I haven't got the article to hand, but if you're fascinated by this, go and look it up. So what they're saying is that this stuff has been out in the cosmos for quite some time, which means that it comes back to what I was saying before, that a lot of these musical geniuses, not just the classical ones such as Bach and Mozart and Beethoven and so forth, have channeled this information. It already exists. It was brought through to them. But I remember I heard on the radio today Bruce Springsteen's coming to town shortly, and I remember an interview that he did once years ago, and saying that when it came to a few of his songs, he'd just woken up in the middle of the night and just had to write these songs down, and they came to him in a matter of minutes. Now, nobody can create a song in a matter of minutes, so I would have to say that it was channeled. And a lot of people, Elton John, guys like that, often say that they've channeled music through. Most people don't like to admit it, of course, because it's just not the done thing. But yeah, absolutely, music. And as I said, anyone at the top of their field or at the top of their game will have had considerable help with channeling and support from guides. So you're right, Janet, you don't have to have the perfect singing voice. But I do believe that if there's no one else around and you don't care, then you should go for it at the top of your lungs anyway. And I always say that about singing, particularly to children. It doesn't matter whether you're in tune or not. They don't care. It's the sound of your voice. It's the cadence. When your voice rises and lowers and stops and starts, that's the stuff that they are listening to. That's the stuff that brings them joy. So absolutely, music for joy is a huge thing. But we'll get on to, in just a moment, what brings people joy. Just had somebody pop up called Tiger. Hi, Tiger. Welcome. For those of you that are new, we'll do a bit of blatant self-promotion. My name is Kim Mehlhopt. I work as a psychic medium and a Reiki and intuitive healer under the name Sounds Like Spirit. My favorite things are teaching and spiritual counseling. That's about using your intuition and passing on messages that other people may have been receiving in their physical life, but not picking up on. So if you can pass that information on to them and make their path a wee bit clearer or their next move a wee bit more obvious, then I love to do that. You can hook up with me online. You can friend me personally, Kim Mehlhopt. You'll find me as admin on the Sounds Like Spirit page, which is where, as I said, to make you all jealous, we advertise all our local expos and things like that, and there are a lot. We're very spiritually active here in Christchurch. I just had a wee note from my producer telling me, last half hour, breathe. I want to thank you all so much at this point for joining me today. I didn't know what to expect or who to expect, so I'm very excited that you've all turned up in the chat room and that I'm not just sitting here talking to myself. Well, that's a reasonably common occurrence if you ask anyone who knows me. Joy, I just want to come back to this. As I said, it is our reason for being. I'd like to let that sink in for just a moment. Joy is our reason for being. Now, the biggest complaint I hear when I'm talking to people about finding joy in their life, and when things aren't going well in your life, everything from work to relationships to issues with family members and stuff like that, you've often forgotten how worthy you are and how deserving you are of joy. And the thing I hear most often is, but I don't know what brings me joy. I don't know what I'm passionate about. And usually I let these people talk for a bit because the answer is always in the question. That's what I believe. The answer is always in the question. It may just be that my guides are on point, but I'd like to take you all back to when you were very, very young, maybe 2 years of age or 3 or 4, sometime around there. If you don't remember this time in your life, ask someone who does. This is if you haven't found your passion. Mothers and fathers are very good for that, obviously, sisters, aunties and uncles, friends who have known you since primary school or kindergarten, as we call it here, to find out what you did as a child. Now, when a soul is newly physical, newly minted, whatever you want to call it, you're very, very close to your higher self, to your soul at that point. And children don't worry about what happened yesterday, and they certainly don't care about what's happening 2 hours from now or what's going on or what they're supposed to be wearing. They really don't care about that sort of thing. You'll notice all they care about is what they're doing right now. Thank you for that, Dimitri. Wonderful show. Yes. They only care about what you're doing right now. And you could say, hey, and even if it's something they really want to do, like go to the local swimming hole or something like that, if you say, hey, we need to get up and get going, they'll ignore you or they'll go, I just got to finish this. And when you have a look at what it is they're doing, that is close to their passion. So some children you'll notice like to set up stages and perform. Some children like to set up shops and process things or work as a bank. You know, some children like to work in toy kitchens and create food and hand it out to people. And some children like to put bandages and band-aids on toys and teddies and people, and some children like to dig around in the garden and poke bugs up the bum. I had a daughter who used to do that, and now she is a Bachelor of Science biology major and loves working in labs. But the point I'm making is what you do in those moments as a newly physical soul is a key to your purpose, to your passion. And your purpose and your passion are much the same thing. And as I said, it doesn't matter whether you're doing it part-time or whether you're doing it as a full-time job. Janet's just popped in on the chat room there and said she loved to draw. I'm interested to note, Janet, that you put loved past tense. which indicates to me that you don't do it at the moment. So I'd like to give you a little butt kicking right here and now. So for those of you who are witnessing this in the chat room, we've got Janet, Dimitri, Jody Whitewolf, Janet, Tiger. We'd all like you to be witness for the fact that Janet's just received a little butt kicking because she's got some passion, some joy there that it looks like she's not been using. So interesting that it's the first thing that came to mind, Janet, and often those sort of synchronicities are the things that point out what it is that bring you joy. So I just want to take this out and expand it a wee bit. Let's say you were one of those children that liked to dig around in the garden. So have a look at the types of things that you would enjoy if that was the case. You might enjoy gardening, actually physically gardening yourself, or market gardening, growing for other people. You might enjoy working on holistic approaches to the earth, things like going pesticide-free and back to the old means of gardening. You might be interested in things like Lincoln University out here deals with farmland and improving the earth and things like that. You might go into things like marine biology, or you might be fascinated by all things in a laboratory. I'm just going to come back to you, Janet, looking at drawing. You've just stated there that you didn't take it back up. But you look at the things that you can do with drawing. You can do it as a hobby, just for fun, just as a pressure valve for you. You could do it for the joy of giving to others. You might make things like Christmas cards or posters, or do little poems and illustrate them, or books for adults or children and put your pictures in, or you might start writing stories around your pictures. So you could do work in an author type field. You could go into working as an artist, as exhibiting. You could go into a holistic field of some description, using it as healing others. There are lots of people in kindergartens or after-school programs or old folks' homes that I'd love to have someone come in and give them a new talent and a new lease on life and a new way of creating and a new way of channeling information. You could go into teaching, setting up classes. So just there in about 2 minutes, Janet, we've given you a whole heap of things that you can do with your drawing. And you can do these things either as a hobby, or you could move them over time into a full-time job. But if that's what brings you joy and what brings you passion, then whether you're doing it part-time or you're doing it full-time, you need to make sure that is in your life. And I see recently there's a huge upswing in using colouring in books for meditation. Now, it's not the only thing by any means, but anything that shuts down 90% of your brain and shuts up the constant chatter that goes on in there gives you a better chance of connecting with your higher self and, you know, your soul and your spirit guide. So drawing's an excellent way to do that. Tiger's popped in and says she loved to dance and sing with her imaginary friends, and you played house and play school also. I've got news for you, Tiger, my love. They were not imaginary. This is a phrase that's a pet peeve of mine. and it's just like when people say, are you talking to yourself? Nope. Because you're never alone. They were not imaginary friends, okay? They were friends in spirit, or guides in spirit, or family members in spirit. Children often draw other children in spirit. And for the most part, this is harmless. There's no harm in it, unless you get the sense that the child is not visiting, that they are stuck somewhere, in which case, yes, you'd need to do something about that. But if they're not stuck and they're just visiting, then absolutely. So the term imaginary friends is one that does not sit very well with me, because this is a way that we are shut down as children. It's one of those things that people say, you're too old to have an imaginary friend. this is a very, very harmful phrase. They weren't imaginary friends. They were real friends. They just weren't physical friends. And I'm hoping that the next generation come through will have a better handle on some of this stuff. We do this to children all the time. We shut children down all the time. I was fascinated when I asked about what I did as a child to find out that I used to have a lot of premonitions. So very clairvoyant. As a youngster, as a young'un, but it was shut down very, very early on. People would say things when I'd see something and then I was living in it, people would say, oh, deja vu. I disagree with the term deja vu, because either it was a premonition, you've seen it in one form or another, and now you're physically there, or it's a recognition on a soul level of souls or a place that you have lived at before, maybe in a past life or maybe with another soul. So all sorts of things, but imaginary friends, no. Deja vu, no. Coincidences, no. Synchronicities. So there's a lot of phrases that I think could be wiped from the dictionary, and I'd be thrilled to see the back of them. Janet, you're doing a course at college. I'm going to be an art therapist. See, now look, right there. So getting into it. Exciting. I'm excited. It's so exciting when you come upon those things that bring you joy. And it was a phrase coined years ago, and it said that if you do what you love, you never work a day in your life. And what that means, obviously, is if you go to work on a daily basis and you're doing something you're really passionate about, then it doesn't seem like work at all. And I've just had a quick look at the time. It's 11:42 a.m. here in New Zealand, Aotearoa. And that fascinates me endlessly, because you and I have just sat here and talked about, I really don't know what, for the last hour and three quarters, and I'm grateful to have you all here, and it's been fascinating to talk about the things that you've brought up in the chat rooms and things that have come up. And look, Tiger's telling you go for it too, Jenna. Everybody's getting in there behind you. It's funny how you can shop your vibe to people in your physical world, and by that I mean you take an idea that you have, like going to do an art course, and you'll take it to somebody and they'll go, do you really think that's a good idea? And the funny thing is, we self-sabotage with that, because we shop out our vibe. We take these questions to people who we know are going to shoot us down. So instead of trusting our instinct and going for it, quite often years can pass before we end up doing the things that we love to do, because we've been told you won't make a living out of that, or it seems a bit frivolous, or why on earth would you want to do that, or how are you going to give up the money from the income you're currently earning, or what crazy harebrained scheme are you into now? But it's funny how if you don't do it, the yearning for it comes out in other ways, usually physical, not so pleasant. So try and do those things that bring you joy. This brings to mind a lovely lady that was at Circle here last night, and I know she won't mind me mentioning this, but she works in a job where she helps other people. And she helps other people by righting the wrongs, by dealing to injustice in the workplace. And someone came along recently and offered her a job in a similar field with an extra $40,000. And she turned it down. Her friends and her family are all going, you're crazy. You should take that job. You know, you're being ridiculous. But it didn't sit well with her. The job was on the other side of the fence, so to speak. So it was in helping the employers. And although the job was helping them correct the situation and put in better working conditions and things like that, she was very upset about the fact that it wouldn't include them being responsible for the damage that had already been done to those that overworked or were in poor conditions and things like that. So she didn't feel from a spiritual level that she would be able to do that job. And it's hugely important to know that. You've got to go with things that work for you, because jobs that are soul-destroying are exactly that. You know, how do you expect to be happy and joyful and passionate if every day you go to a job that just doesn't do it for you, doesn't turn you on, doesn't excite you, doesn't have you ranting and raving to your friends and family about what a wonderful day you had today? And I'm very lucky to work a couple of what people would consider, I suppose, out-of-the-box jobs as a healer, as a medium, as a singer, and they all bring me joy. So it's a fascinating thing to have. And Janet's just come through saying that everyone's been supportive, which has helped kept it going when things get tough. And that's exactly what I'm talking about, Janet. You know, if you've got things that bring you joy in your life, then those other things that don't bring you so much joy, and let's face it, there are a few of those things quite often. Those things that you're passionate about and the things that bring you joy can help get you through that. So anything that brings you joy is your passion. So when I say that little three-letter word, that joy is the reason we are here, it's all about that purpose and passion. And if you do not know what that is, then absolutely ask someone who knew you when you were teeny tiny in this life, just young, because children are very good at just being. They're very good at being in the now, paying attention only to what's going on right now. They are fully focused on it. they are thrilled about doing it. They wouldn't do it if they didn't want to do it. I know that any of you that have children will back me up on this. If you're trying to get them to do something that they don't want to do, they'll certainly be telling you how that's going to go and showing you through the actions that they're taking that just exactly how that's going to go. But just a quick wrap up here, I'd like to mention that we've talked about attitudinal changes in the last couple of hours, and something I put online last week about valuing yourself called bitter or better, send love. You either get bitter or you get better, and it's that simple. You either take what's been dealt to you and allow it to make you a better person, or you allow it to tear you down. The choice does not belong to fate, it belongs to you. So whenever there's a negative situation in our lives, we tend to visualize and blame the other party. What a total beach. Beach like the ocean. If she hadn't said that, I'd still have a job. He was such a... If it wasn't for his anger management issues, we'd still be together. Why couldn't they keep their mouth shut? If they hadn't stirred the pot, this wouldn't have happened. I'm not asking you to suppress, nor am I asking you to forget these things ever happened. It's made you who you are, blah, blah, blah. But I'm asking you to forgive, send love. Bitter or better is your choice. So choosing to focus on those past hurts or repeating the story over and over to others. Now, that's important. If you've got issues and you repeat those stories over and over to others, you are ingraining that in your psyche. You're ingraining that in your programming. So talking about what we spoke about earlier, about sitting out under a full moon and sit with that pain for a bit, because that allows you to get over it. Then you can stop spreading that story to other people. You can stop carrying it around. You can stop carrying around the knee-jerk emotions and beliefs that you felt at that time, because they will lead to bitter, not better. So understand that someone else's lack of enlightenment can hurt you, but then it helps you to grow. And your homework for the week, as it were, is to send love to 3 people a day and start with those who peeve you off the most. Send love to 3 people a day. Start with those who peeve you off the most, because this leads to better. And start, instead of talking about the things that upset you this week and the people that upset you and the situations that upset you, I'd like you to start gossiping, for want of a better word, about the miraculous things that have happened to you, the synchronicities, the miracles, the fascinating stuff. Start spreading that. That's what I'd like to see spread around. All the good stuff, not the things that have been bothering you. But I'd like to thank you all so much for being here. I haven't done that enough in the last couple of hours. It's been fascinating to sit here talking to you all for the last couple of hours. Here comes the segue into the blatant self-promotion again. My name is Kim Mehlhopt. I work under the name Sounds Like Spirit. You can find me on Facebook. The Facebook page has a heading that looks like a sound bite, and it's where I advertise the events that I do, the physical circles that I do. And if I can get enough of a following on that page, I will start putting out some online circles, which means we can get together like this. I'm not saying I'm technologically stupid, but I'm not as advanced as I could be. And once I get those things sorted, we'll start doing some online development circles. All the events that I'll be attending or running or hosting or whatever you like to call it here on SOC Radio will be listed under those events. If you do like that page and subscribe to it, you'll get notifications directly about these radio shows, and you'll be able to join me in the chat rooms. At different times, I would love to have some of you on as guests on the show and talk to you. Because everybody has an opinion. I'm a firm believer of that. You don't need to be a psychic medium or particularly strong in any of your clear senses or working in any of the healing modalities. I believe that everybody has something to say. Everybody has spiritual experiences that they have come across in their life that they need to talk to people about. I've got a message come up from the lovely Julie, and I can only see part of it, but it's about the spiritualists online. I'm guessing she wants me to mention the forum chat show, which is on Saturday, New Zealand time in the morning this Saturday. And it's where we get a whole bunch of spiritualists who work in the field. So mediums, clairaudients, clairvoyants, healers, people who run publications. And we talk about things that are topical in the spiritual field at the moment, things that We're working on pet peeves, any questions anybody wants to know on how we work and what we do. Thank you so much to Christina, who's been in on out on the chat show. She's telling me it was a great show. Oh, stop, people. You'll give me an ego. everybody has one, of course, but we try and keep it under control for the most part. Absolutely, you're all welcome to send me personal friend requests. You're welcome to like the Sounds Like Spirit page where I talk about the business. You're welcome to, there is a link on that to the Sounds Like Spirit group, which is absolutely all free online messages, mostly channeled, to be fair, that I pass through every day. I'd like to take the credit for it myself, but to be fair, most of my stuff is channeled. Synchronicities give me my topics to talk about for the day. And I started this up about a year ago. I initially, selfish reasons, and I don't like to use that word particularly because we're talking about things that bring you joy. And when I learned how to read in public, platform readings and stuff like that, I wanted to do some practicing and somebody said do some work online and I didn't really know how to do that. So I thought, well, I'll start a page and I'll do some readings online. And the first two people that I read for came through. One of them had been physically abused numerous times in her life and very recently by someone she knew. And someone had been cutting themselves and had been thinking about suicide. Now, I don't actually believe there's any such thing as suicide prevention. If people are determined to do it, they will do it. If that's their journey, they'll journey there. But I suddenly realized that what do people do every other day of the week? So I started this Sounds Like Spirit page as a support group for people who are wanting to develop themselves spiritually. I wanted to try and put things in the clearest terms possible. I want to start from the bottom up. So if I'm explaining to you about how to use a pendulum, I'll start at the beginning. I'll tell you where you can buy them, how to choose it, what to do before you use it, the types of questions you ask. Because I'd been to development circles myself and I was made to feel inadequate, for want of a better word. It's not that I'm not very talented, everybody is, but I was made to feel inadequate about the things that I didn't know. And they assumed that because they'd been doing these things for years and using these tools for years that everybody knew. And although some people knew, and you do get a mix of talents and skills at a development circle, not everybody knows everything. And I didn't like to assume that everybody did. So I started this to give information on particular topics. People can message me and ask about particular topics and I'll try and get that up either on the Sounds Like Spirit group on Facebook or on the development circles that I do. And as I said, I am hoping to run those online shortly for those of you who have shown interest. So I'd like to thank all of you that have been listening in because I know there's more than just those who pop into the chat room. There are others that listen online at spiritualistsonline.com. So if you have... you're obviously, I'm preaching to the converted, if you're listening to this, you are hearing, but you are welcome to share that around, so spiritualistsonline.com, and you can listen to this show and heaps of other lovely shows that pop in here. As I said, we've got the chat show forum coming up this Saturday, and I'll be there hosting for the first hour. If you've got any topics that you'd like to talk about in this weekly show that I'm doing here, all you need to do is let me know. And I'm happy to spout any and everything that I know about it or look into it for you for the following week's show. So thank you all for coming. We've had Janet here. We've given her a wee butt kicking. Sorry, my darling, but I see you're already on it. Good on you. We've had Dimitri, Christina, Carol C. Thank you so much for thanking me. Tracy, Tiger. We've had Jodie Whitewolf popping in and out. Apologies if I have forgotten or missed everybody, anyone, because these do roll up and down. I'd like to thank Colin for producing this show and Julie for helping out as well. Christina did ask earlier, did I have a development circle online or just in my area? At the moment, just in my area in Christchurch, but I am looking at doing that online, opening that up somehow. So I just need to figure out how to do the tech stuff for that, and absolutely, probably through Skype Business or something like that from what I can gather. I don't charge a lot for development circles because I believe in sharing the love. Sharing the love, that's what I'm all about, sharing the love. I'm not sure how many swear words you're allowed to use on radio in any given 2 hours, but as my daughter is fond of saying, I'm a being of light and love and I spread that shit everywhere. So I'd like you all to concentrate on doing exactly that this week, to being a being of light and love and spreading that everywhere, because I believe that, the way to heal the world is to help yourself and then to help your neighbour, help the person next to you. Thanks so much for being here, all of you guys. Christina, thank you so much. Jodie Wywolf, it's been fun. Yes, it has. I've really enjoyed it, and I hope that 2 hours of the sound of my voice hasn't put you off coming back next week. So I'm getting a note from the producer here to close out, so this is all new to me. Thank you so much for bearing with me and coping with me. I'm a very open person. I try to be honest to the best of my nature. I try to spread as much information as I can. To those of you here, maybe you can put questions and topics in the message board so you can see them. You can absolutely write them anywhere you want. I'm sure Julie will let me know if it's something I don't know about or haven't looked at very often. And you're welcome to give me ideas in any given show for the show for next week. So I'll wrap that up and let them move on to whatever it is they've got planned next. But once again, I'd like to thank Colin and Julie for producing today. I'd like to thank you all for being in the chat room and giving me something to talk about. It's not that I'm not a big talker, as you can tell. Seriously, who gave me my own show? Julie. It's not that I can't talk forever about anything and everything. Everything fascinates me, and if it's fascinated you too in the last 2 hours, then I thank you very much for your company. For those that have listened online but not joined the chat room, thank you very much, and I'm hoping you may be able to pop into the chat rooms next week and join me there. So I just like to thank you all for coming and remind you that you can contact me online in Sounds Like Spirit, and that there are plenty of fantastic shows coming up here on SOC Radio. So from the bottom of my heart, or as we say in my family, the heart of my bottom, I'd like to thank you very much for being here today. And we'll catch you here, me, Sounds Like Spirit, on Sound Advice for Spiritual Souls here on SOC Radio next week. Thank you so much for your company.
You are listening to SOC Radio at spiritualistsonline.com. SOC Radio does not claim ownership of any music rights or copyright therein. And there is no copyright infringement intended. Have a show idea? Have you always wanted to host your own show? Well, contact us at socradioshows@gmail.com. Let your dream begin here.